Well, it's safe to say St. Louis is a sports town. And if football isn't our favorite sport, the dollars say it is in the rest of the country. And safe to say, we could soon lose our team. So what are the Rams worth to St. Louis? What are the costs of trying to keep the team? Are they worth it? Is it too late? Stay tuned. And on Stay Tuned, you drive the discussion. We bring local experts, journalists, and civic leaders together to have tough conversations for a stronger St. Louis. Tweet us your insights on tonight's topic, and you've got a seat at the table. With a few national experts and a panel of community members, this is the show bringing more light and less heat to the issues that matter. So stay tuned. Well, it seems just about every day there is something new to report when it comes to the Rams and whether they will stay or whether they will go. So before we get started, let's get caught up as best we can. Two stadiums in two different towns in 1 week. First, Rams owner Stan Kroenke announced a plan to build an 80,000-seat stadium in Los Angeles, a sure signal for many that the billionaire plans to move the Rams to L.A. While not quite the bended knee it was on when St. Louis first got the Rams to commit, the city did offer a seemingly serious counter-proposal, a 64,000-seat stadium right on the river just north of the Arch, a roughly $900 million plan that city leaders and plan advisors say would not require any new taxes. About half of the cost would come from the team and the league, and the other half from a refinancing and extension of debt on the Dome. The details, they say, are forthcoming and sure to be debated.
This is not about the owner of the Rams. The Rams are our team, okay? This is St. Louis's team. You know, owners own the franchise, but the fan base and the popularity and the passion behind that team, it's owned by the fan base. This is our team.
But not everyone believes this is the best play for St. Louis. Beyond public investment, several buildings would have to be torn down for stadium parking.
The proposed stadium would annihilate a whole swath of historic, cultural, and economic resources.
LA backers say the stadium there could be built by 2018. St. Louis says 2020 for its new stadium. The NFL says the Rams are in St. Louis at least through 2015. Okay, we're starting tonight with two veteran sports broadcasters here in St. Louis, Randy Carricker, 101 ESPN Radio, and Alvin Reed, of course, Donnybrook, and also STOMag.com. Let's just take a step back for a second. I said football might not be our favorite sport, but I bet it was 15 years ago, 1999 Rams. What do you remember about this town when they won the Super Bowl?
Well, 15 years ago tonight, we were a lot of St. Louisans couldn't sleep because we were getting ready for the Super Bowl tomorrow on January 30th. And because we hadn't experienced home playoff games before, hadn't experienced quality football before, this town was more galvanized and more jazzed than I had ever seen it, even for any of the Cardinal World Series. I thought what happened was really special. It really did bring our town together, and I think that's one of the things that sports does. I was down in Atlanta. I was working. It was amazing how many people from St. Louis made their way down to Atlanta and partied and spent money there. The amount of money spent on the team during those 3 years was sensational. But I'll tell you what, 15 years ago tonight, I don't think I did sleep.
Well, I've been going back a few years before that. After my career all around the United States, when I moved back to St. Louis for good, we still had the house in the Washington, D.C. area, but I was coming back to stay. I was not, going to go back. I was crossing the Poplar Street Bridge when they were having the press conference announcing that the Rams were indeed officially going to come to St. Louis.
1994.
I thought that was, I said, man, the football team and Alvin are coming back to St. Louis on the same day. I thought that was really cool. I was in Atlanta, too, and one of the things I remember about that were how few of us were actually there. The number of people that were in the building, and then you start talking about media members and how many fans, there were only 10 to 15,000 St. Louisans that were actually there at the Super Bowl. And I always look back and I said, the one thing that we didn't get to experience was what was happening that Saturday night and that Sunday in St. Louis. And it was right. really something special. Just by, you know, at that time I did have a cell phone, you know, as big as my head probably, but there are people calling and saying, like, what's it like down there? What's it like? And you're saying, like, well, it's 8 o'clock in the morning, you know, and it was just a fantastic weekend. It was a fantastic week down there, and it was really, truly special. And it's hard to imagine that this franchise leaving this city based upon what went on that week, and really 2 weeks later, and 2 years later, I mean, in New Orleans.
Well, and germane to what we're talking about, what was it like maybe 13 years before that, if I'm doing the math correctly, when the football Cardinals left town?
That was interesting. And Bill Bidwell is still reviled here. And
the owner of the...
Right, of the football Cardinals. And Bill Bidwell just didn't fit in with the leadership of the town at that time, with the guys from Civic Progress. He wanted a new stadium, actually where the Dome is, and they were dead set against it. Gene McNary offered a stadium out in the county. Civic Progress said, well, we aren't going to participate. We aren't going to buy luxury suites or club seats in a stadium in the county. So they made sure that if there was an offer forthcoming, it was going to be in the city, and it never really wound up being a strong offer. He had no choice, because in that NFL, he couldn't have been able to exist. Now, it took him a long time to get a stadium, as it turned out, in Arizona, but that was strictly an economic and business move. He could not have existed as an NFL franchise here.
Sounds similar to what we're hearing today.
Well, the difference today is that you've got a guy with $5.6 billion, and you've got a league where with TV money, you don't need to sell a ticket to make money. You can exist without having a person in your stands, and you can make a lot of money because of the TV and NFL merchandising deals. This is a personal enrichment situation for Stan Kroenke. We call it a business deal. Well, it's his business. It's not the ability to have a football team that's successful. If he had the Dome, they pay $250,000 a year rent in the Dome. They pay $25,000 a game per Sunday or Saturday for preseason games for the Dome. They could succeed, but they don't make enough money for him, and the value of the franchise isn't great enough. He'll enrich himself to the tune of just moving to L.A., $1.5 billion. Franchise value will go from roughly $1.93 billion, to $2.5 million the day it moves.
Right. And he's one of the few franchises that is less than $1 billion. He's one of the few franchises that the like you say, the amount of money that you make is in the bottom, not in the bottom third, it's like one of the last two. That changes. If we could lift our house up, our house and our land, and move it to California, obviously it would be worth a lot more money. Same thing you said, right. It's personal enrichment. And it's hard to deny the fact that, you know, what are you supposed to do? Right. We can make you stay here, says the league, maybe, but if you don't want to be here, and you don't have a lease, and you don't have really any, other than the league rules, not any legal authority to keep you here, it's going to be tough to keep him here.
Casey, I want to make one point here, because we do talk about his personal enrichment. But from a league standpoint, obviously, they've said that the Dome isn't adequate now. 20 years into our Dome, 25 years into the existence of the Dome, we've got to move. It's got to be a different building for the NFL to accept it. And that means a larger footprint. That means the ability to make more money for the team within that building.
So why do you think we should try to keep the Rams? And if so, why should we? Or is it too late?
Well, I don't think that the object of the game should not be to keep the Rams, because ultimately I don't think we're going to keep the Rams. Do we keep this place as an NFL franchise? I think that's possible. And that's why a new stadium, I guess, has to be built, because the league has said as much. One of the things
So build a stadium regardless if we know who the team is going to be?
Yes, I could see going in that direction, how it's financed, and all those things have to be basically worked out. I do say this, too, and I know that I'm kind of in the minority of this, just like I was when I was saying 3 years ago, even more than that, that this day could be possibly coming. A lot of people said I was crazy and, you know, all that, and said, well, fine, but I could kind of see this coming down the pike. But who said the stadium has to be in the city? Now, the edict may be that it has to be in a blighted area. West County Mall at one time was considered blighted, and, you know, it is now doing much, much better. So, but I'm not one that buys in that it has to be in the city of St. Louis. So, yes, I think it is one that you proceed with a stadium plan. Don't lock yourself on to, you know, near North Side down by the river. Just try to make it work where it can work. And I think that is something that the region should pursue.
One thing we learned with the departure of the football Cardinals is it costs a whole lot more to get another team than to keep the team that you have. So the pursuit should be to keep the Rams, to try to abide by the NFL's bylaws and try to get them to abide by their own bylaws to keep the Rams here. And if that doesn't work, if Stan Kroenke and the league are dead set on his stadium in California, then you have no choice. But if you want another team, then to pursue another team. But there are so many ancillary things. We talked about how great the city was and how excited it was 15 years ago. The Rams were named the Philanthropic Organization of the Year in St. Louis in 2010. Anheuser-Busch was still a headquarter here. Of all the businesses in St. Louis, the Rams, according to the people that made that decision, did more in our community from a charitable standpoint. It's unbelievable, really, to look at the Rams. Go to the Rams website, stlouisrams.com. Look at what they do in the community. Those are things that you can't get if you don't have an NFL team. The benefit that an NFL team brings, even if it's not that great, are things that you just can't get elsewhere.
And I've said that on an earlier show that, you know, have experts come in, it really doesn't do anything financially for you and all that. So, like, I think it's really intangible, and I don't think it can be measured economically, the economic impact that an NFL franchise had. It does pay off in dollars. It's hard to ascertain what those dollars are, but I guarantee you it does have a financial impact on the positive.
Okay, gentlemen, we want to add a voice at the table to this conversation, but we also want to add some voices from you using hashtag StayTunedSTL. You've already been talking. Let's hear what you're saying.
This is going to create economic development that wouldn't have otherwise happened. You know, we're hoping that not instead of going to the movies or going out to eat, that people are doing that and additionally spending new funds, you know, on the sports team and, you know, other businesses kind of in the surrounding area. But if, you know, the case is that people's entertainment budgets are fixed, then it's going to be kind of a substitutable decision as opposed to a complementary one. As economists, the goal is always to try to quantify things as best we can and, you know, attach dollars and cents and numbers where possible. But certainly, you know, a great economic idea that's, you know, hard to quantify is the idea of utility. You know, certainly, you know, it's nice to have the Rams in town and wake up in the morning and be able to read the paper and read coverage on the Rams. You know, there's a lot of non-monetary good that comes about from, you know, having the Rams in town as far as, you know, morale, you know, enjoyment, and making St. Louis a more attractive public destination.
So maybe it doesn't always quite pencil out, like you were saying. We're joining us at the table now, Missy Kelly from Downtown STL Incorporated. Missy, we talk a lot about here on the show, and just in the, you see it in the paper, you see it on TV, startups, high tech, transit, things millennials want. Not comparing ourselves to cities like Chicago and kind of reshaping our own identity. Do we need an NFL team to accomplish any of the things we've been talking about here in St. Louis?
I think we do, absolutely. I mean, it's an asset that we currently have. So, you know, it's not like it's one that we're seeking, we have it. So I think there are two aspects to this. Number one, we don't want to lose it. I think that certainly in the context of what's gone on in St. Louis over the last year, it would take on a little bit more meaning than just losing an NFL football team.
Explain what you mean.
So we've had a rough go over the last 6 to 9 months. Just the region with the safety and security issues, the diversity issues that have come to the surface. And I would echo what Randy said a little bit earlier about sports being something that brings people together. It doesn't matter what, you know, when we're all rooting for the Cardinals or for the Rams, it doesn't matter how many zeros are in our paycheck, which neighborhood we live in, we are all behind a common cause. And so I think sporting events have been something that St. Louis has done really well for a really long time. So I think that, you know, we have a bit of a battered reputation, you know, in the national media over the last 6 to 9 months. And I feel like if we would lose an NFL team, it would carry a meaning that goes a little bit beyond just losing an NFL team. It would very likely be lumped into, have a bigger connotation for why that happened.
Are sports that big? I mean, we get a little cynical sometimes. These guys are making millions upon millions of dollars to play a child's game.
Yeah. Full disclosure, it's my profession. So I would say yes, but
it's pretty big.
From a couple of standpoints. Number one, I think one of the things that we do really well, and probably the thing we do best in St. Louis, is sports. There are things, we've got a great zoo, we've got a great symphony orchestra, we've got the startups that Missy talked about. But what St. Louis should strive to be is the best sports town. We're chasing Indianapolis in that regard right now. Indy has got the NCAA, they built their new stadium, they're gonna have a Final Four every 4 years, 5 years. And I think that that's something that we should take pride in. And I think the other thing that, and I know there are a lot of people that don't love the idea of, or don't like at all the idea of a new stadium. I use all of the aspects of St. Louis. I'm a Muni season ticket holder. I use Creve Coeur Park to ride my bike. I must admit, I don't use the Symphony Orchestra, but I don't begrudge people that do. I see no reason why we can't have it all. I think that we can be great and have all of those things. And I don't know why anybody would want to begrudge the people that do enjoy football the opportunity to go see it. And I do think, when you talk about the millennials, and I think we'll hear this later, this is something that draws people to St. Louis. I think if you're trying, Missy, you can help me here. I think if you're trying to draw companies to St. Louis, having an NFL team is better than not having an NFL team.
Absolutely. Talent, bringing different talent in, and they look at all of the things that the city has to offer. I mean, 22 of the top 23 MSAs in the country have an NFL team, and that one that doesn't is LA, and they're trying to get two right now. So I think that, you know, if we want to be a top-tier city, remain at least on par with other top-tier cities, this is something that we need to keep. It's one more asset that we have that is attractive to multi-generations and again, to different people of different diversities.
Yeah. First paper I worked at, Danville, Illinois. One day, shortly I'd been there, fax machine blows up. We're in the media contingent of the Indianapolis Colts. They moved in the middle of the night to Indianapolis, okay? From there, you said, like, we have a football team. Same thing, mm-hmm. Next paper, Lansing, Michigan. We had hockey and had all these things. Never mind the college there at Michigan State, but you had the Detroit Lions, you had the Detroit Red Wings, you had the Detroit Tigers. You made the trip down. So the same way, because the team is here in St. Louis, now we know this from the Cardinals. Where do people come from to see the Cardinals play? Oklahoma, Arkansas, Illinois, Iowa, from all over. The same thing is true with
the Rams. From the old coverage area, yeah, KMOX.
Yeah, exactly.
But I get the analogy.
People make the trip. Now, they may not be season ticket holders, but they come to see a game, mm-hmm. and it may be a preseason game. That's what's like, oh, nobody comes to see preseason games. So, like, no, people with their families might come down, spend the weekend, go see a preseason game.
Do we have hard numbers? Is it really, does it pencil out to have an NFL team? Is there a monetary benefit?
You know, again, I would just say that if 22 of the 23 top-tier cities have it, I got to believe that there's, you know, that it's paying out. I certainly don't have the numbers for that. But I would say that, you know, when you have an asset like an NFL team, you then bring people downtown or to the city, and they then enjoy the other assets that downtown has to offer. I mean, we've got now with the City Arch River project, you know, underway and the arch grounds being almost, well, very well underway. Once all of that is complete, there will be a very inviting pedestrian path to the many assets that downtown has to offer. We have one square mile, and all of the professional sports teams are within one square mile, and that's just the sports teams. Then you have the museums and the green space that we'll have. So I think the economic impact is significant.
Sorry to put you on the spot. Frank Cusimano did a report. I think it's like $7.9 million in income tax alone that the state gets from the NFL, $500,000 or so the city.
Right,
gets.
And that doesn't even include the tax on things like concessions and merchandising.
Correct, right?
So that $12 million that the state is paying, as Dave Peacock said at the press conference, there's a net benefit to the Rams being here, at least from a tax standpoint. The other point that I was going to make is that obviously Rams fans have been beaten down, but when they were winning, and even when they drafted Sam Bradford, there was more than even a regional draw. A lot of people came here from Oklahoma and bought season tickets to watch the Rams to see Sam Bradford play. And we talk about the Cardinals and the amount of people that they draw from the region. Well, down in Jacksonville right now, Mark Lamping is marketing the Jaguars in the exact same way. He's got Jaguars caravans. He's marketing to an entire region rather than just the Jacksonville area. And there's nothing better than the NFL to set up for that. Have people come in on a Saturday night, watch the game on a Sunday, and then go home on Sunday night. It works out perfectly.
Right. If you've ever been to Jacksonville, he's got a tougher sell than we have in St. Yeah. Louis. I mean, that's reality. One, they're big on college football, but please, Jacksonville is where Jacksonville is. Okay. And the weather doesn't cooperate early because it's too hot. And it's just, they got a tougher sell, but yet, you know, they're making it go. We can make it go here. Ask the Drury, ask the Four Seasons, ask those hotels downtown. If there was no football team, what would this mean to you? It's like, it would mean less employees. It would mean less revenue. It would mean less taxes. It would mean less. And some cities could say 12 days don't make a difference. St. Louis is not one of those. Those 12 are very important.
We've established there is an upside. Let's see where the rest of the show takes us. We'll see what other folks have to say, including you. We want to get back to Stay Tuned STO, the hashtag.
Which stands on the site of Sportsman's Park, where the St. Louis Cardinals played until 1966 when they moved to Busch Memorial Stadium downtown. Baseball was played on this site for over 80 years. I mean, this is really a good example of something that seemed like it would last forever, but didn't. I mean, 80 years. The stadium has not been any state. No stadium in St. Louis has been on any site for 80 years yet. So this seemed permanent, and a whole web network of economics related to the site, bars, restaurants, a YMCA, a hotel where the baseball players from out of town would stay up on Natural Bridge, the Fairgrounds Hotel. All that went kaput, all that went dormant when the Cardinals decided to move downtown. This is a cautionary tale, if there ever was one. This entire neighborhood has changed. Anyone who was here in the 1960s wouldn't recognize it now. Hopefully we'll never say that about anything in downtown around the stadiums we have today, but you never know. We might find out.
Well, if your Twitter feed looked at all like mine when the new stadium plans were announced here in St. Louis, you may have seen a warning from Hartford, Connecticut, of all places, saying essentially, don't do it, St. Louis. Joining us now from Hartford, Connecticut, the author of the article out of the Hartford Current is Dan Haar. Dan, welcome to Stay Tuned. We appreciate you being here.
Thank you very much. It's great to be in St. Louis virtually.
Well, it's more than virtually good to have you. What can St. Louis learn from Hartford? Why are you telling us that we should not build this stadium in the hopes of maintaining our status as an NFL city?
Well, there are two issues going on. There seem to be two camps in this. One camp says we need to build this stadium at all costs because we need to remain an NFL stadium, and downtown is a great place to put it. And the other camp says don't build a stadium, it's a bad thing. I'm in the camp that says you guys should have a football team there with a stadium. Downtown is the wrong place to put it. Because if stadiums generate economic activity, and there's a great debate about whether they do, as you well know, they certainly do not help downtowns being open 8 to 10 games a year, depending on whether you count the preseason as a game. And of course, there's always a hope, even in St. Louis, for a playoff game.
Who knows what the next team will be? They might be better than the one we've got.
Well, that's right.
But you're speaking from a little bit of a personal experience in Hartford. Can you give us the analogy you're making there?
Hartford is a city that was a once great national major city in the 19th century. We're still a pretty good, you know, second or third tier city in terms of size. We're a little bit less than half the size of the market in St. Louis. Unfortunately for Hartford, in the late 50s and 60s, we were cursed with money. Hartford was a politically powerful and rich place. It's still rich. And we had money to tear down the heart of the city, including the riverfront. We had money to build right along the river, which was expensive but stupid. And we now have no access to the riverfront, and most importantly, no human scale development along the river on which a lot of cities have rebuilt in the age of this sort of millennial generation. And so I'm suggesting that St. Louis is someday, I understand there's not a lot of hue and cry right now for that property up there just north of Laclede's Landing, but there will be someday, and that's going to be part of a broad stretch from south of the Arch all the way to the Stan Musial. That's going to be the renaissance of St. Louis, if it needs one. You guys are well ahead of us already.
So there's a physical cost, you're saying, that money can't replace.
Yes, that's exactly right. Now, when you look at the building that's there, the old Power and Light building, I understand that's going to be saved. But putting something in the middle of all that, and I'm not even talking about the cost of $300 million of preparing the site, which is by Peacock and Blitz's own report, that's the cost, $325 million. I'm not even saying, hey, that's too much to spend. I'm saying exactly what you said. The physical proximity of those old industrial human scale buildings that look like blight today are someday a treasure. Hartford wishes we had ours back. We tore down 8 to 16, depending on how you count it, city blocks in the 50s and 60s. If we had those back, we could become a much more vibrant metropolitan area today, built on that.
Is there something you've done right that you would like us to know?
Well, there's a lot of things that Hartford did right. I think the convention center down there by the river has been helpful. I think putting the football stadium, as you may know, we were duped into offering Robert Kraft, and I'm not a fan of the Patriots for partly that reason. Of course, I'm also from New York. We were duped into offering a stadium to him for the full cost of the stadium in 1998, and he sort of played Connecticut and then pulled out of town. What we did that was smart was build a 40,000-seat college football stadium for University of Connecticut, which went up to the highest Division I level, across the river. You can't really do that because you're dealing with two different states. Really, East St. Louis, Illinois would be a great place for a stadium, but it's not one region, it's two states, and I know there's that problem. That's one thing we did that was smart.
Dan, thanks for your time. Thanks for your insight. Thanks for taking an interest in St. Louis. We all appreciated your article. It was definitely passed around by a lot of people, and it certainly adds to the conversation. We appreciate your time tonight. Dan Haar.
Well, I thank you. I appreciate it. My brother's there, and I love the city.
Well, nice of you to get a shout-out in. That's good. Thanks to your brother as well. All right. Thank you, Dan. Let's go back to social media, see what you're saying. Okay, we're adding to the table. Randy's staying with us. Coming to the table now, Steve Patterson, UrbanReviewSTL.com, and also Brian Felt, St. Louis Business Journal. Welcome back to the show. So let's just pick up right what we just heard there. Is there a better place than downtown for this stadium? We've heard things like the old Chrysler plant in Fenton. He mentioned East St. Louis.
We're a huge region. There are plenty of places other than downtown to put a stadium. The idea that everything it happens in the region, it has to be downtown, is kind of a false idea. We're lucky that with the fact that in the 1960s, the St. Louis Symphony decided to be in Midtown rather than downtown, even though in the 60s it was very in vogue to be in a downtown location with a brand new building. They chose to renovate an old building in a place other than downtown. So we need to think about places other than besides downtown to put a stadium.
I'm surprised to hear you say that, because I know I hear you preach the importance of the urban core, no matter what any particular issue might be. But you're saying it could be okay in another spot. Are other people talking about this?
Well, before the Fenton plant, the Chrysler plant in Fenton was taken over, and now that's going to be developed. If anybody's ever tried to get to Six Flags during a summer day and driven on 44, you know what the traffic would be like. That's for 20,000 people. Can you imagine what it would be like for 70,000? The only other place that really has an intersection of two highways right now, there's a couple. If you could find land near the airport, and by the way, I don't think that the FAA would allow you to build at that intersection of 170 and 70, and the other one would be the Page Extension and 141. I don't know how much land would be out there. I do know that Metrolink doesn't run out there, and many, many Rams fans show up to the games on Metrolink. If you build where they're talking about building, you've got the Laclede station plus the convention center Metrolink stops, you've got all the access to downtown, and you've got the convergence of three different highways. I've been a Rams season ticket holder since 1995. One of the great things about our area, as opposed to Kansas City, and I know a lot of people love the idea of tailgating for 3 hours after a game, but it takes 3 hours to get out of that parking lot. You can get back home from a Rams game in an hour if you live in the county, and that includes dealing with all the traffic with garages. So I think from that standpoint, I haven't seen a better spot for ingress and egress.
And NFL teams, correct me if I'm wrong, they love, speaking of the tailgating, they love parking, right?
Yes.
Why is that? What's the business model behind all the parking?
Well, there's definitely plenty of parking in the model that we've seen from Mr. Peacock.
Which is a problem for a lot of people. We just heard the gentleman from Connecticut talking about the cost of the
structures.
Well, in St.
Louis specifically, you know, there's plenty of people out in the suburbs, and the Metrolink doesn't go out to all the suburbs. So people are coming in, driving there, and they're going to need places to park, and yeah.
Well, think about the money. It's 10,000 spots at $30, $40, $50 a spot. That's an awful lot of money for 8 Sundays a year and 2 other days. And that's something that the Rams have. The Blues are the only team in the NHL that doesn't get parking money, and that's one of the reasons that they have the financial difficulties that they do. And obviously the Cardinals, when the DeWitt family bought the team, they sold the garages, but they've got the parking now at Ballpark Village. But that's a huge revenue generator for all sports teams.
And do the Rams want more parking than they have now? Obviously they want
a
whole new stadium.
They have nothing. The Rams don't get any parking revenue at all. There's that McGuire moving and storage lot just north of the Dome. There's the MAC lot across the street. They don't get any money from any parking at all. And they're one of the few teams. There might be two teams in the NFL that don't get parking revenue.
Steve, let's say that they do build a stadium where they're talking about building it. Is that good for the rest of downtown? It's not exactly in downtown. I know we've heard people on business owners on Washington Avenue say that just Ballpark Village has hurt Washington Avenue. Is this something that could actually be a benefit to downtown? Is it close enough, do you think?
It wouldn't help at all. The argument that people can leave quickly is exactly what would happen. Everyone would get in their cars and they would leave. There wouldn't be any benefit to downtown at all. And you couldn't walk to the stadium from the Metrolink anyway.
Sure you can. It's just across the street from Lumiere. I used to work on the landing, and I rode Metrolink to go to work almost every day. And there would be no problem in walking right past Lumiere to this stadium.
I use a wheelchair. I've tried it. It doesn't work.
Okay.
We have a lot of work to do to make the connection.
Doesn't work for everyone.
Yeah. Doesn't work for everyone, yes.
Let's go back to Stan Kroenke for just a second, since we've got the business reporter here at the table. This is definitely seems like an emotionless decision he's making. Fair assessment.
Yeah.
Is that something we need to do as well? Are we kind of tied into this emotionally?
Well, for Stan, obviously the Rams in a new stadium in L.A. is a much more valuable asset than the Rams in a new stadium in St. Louis. I think it's probably close to $1 billion that we're talking about a difference here. In terms of what it would mean for Kroenke in St. Louis, I think what he wants to do is potentially make any situation for the Rams something like Patriot Place in New England and its relationship with Gillette Stadium. It's Gillette Stadium where the Patriots play is essentially a field in the middle of a mall that is just a cash cow for the Kraft family. And I think that's what Kroenke ultimately wants to do.
Can he do that in the location he's talking about? Do you think where they have to build stuff to go with it? I mean, you don't make money once the car is parked in those parking
lots. Well, potentially down the road, I guess you could, but right now, as the model is, they would have to acquire more land because right now it's just a stadium and a bunch of parking lots.
Is he playing both towns against each other? I got a former St. Louis Post-Dispatch reporter, Tim Logan, who now works for LA Times. He was in town. He told me neither town thinks they're going to have this team.
My sense is that Stan Kroenke, and I said this in September, that the Rams have made a decision to move to Los Angeles. And the LA Times report last week that he had started negotiations 18 months ago and reached a handshake agreement last March to build this stadium in LA. I think that Stan wants to be in LA. I don't think that there's any playing of St. Louis here. I think that's one of the reasons that he hasn't said anything. I think he desperately wants to be in LA because of what Brian talked about. It could be a real financial windfall for him. And by the way, it's really hard in sports. It's different than other companies, I think, with sports because we do get emotionally involved. When you buy a ticket, you buy because you want to be emotionally invested. But from a business standpoint, I'm not one of those at all costs keep the Rams people. I don't think we should at all costs. But I do think that there has to be a level of emotion because of what we talked about before, where we were 15 years ago right now. You want to keep that asset and hopefully relive what we had in 1999.
And I think that officials have come to grips with that. Obviously, they said they're looking to keep St. Louis an NFL city. They're not necessarily pointing to the Rams each and every time. Do they want to keep the Rams? Yes, but they also want to make St. Louis an NFL city.
Do you care if the Rams stay or go?
Makes a difference to me.
Do you think people that read your website care?
I polled them, actually, and they don't seem to care.
So, and the people on my radio station, 100% of them want to keep the Rams. Yeah. So I guess it depends on what demographic you're talking about. And I know there was a poll done, I think, on, I don't know who did it, but 70% of people said they wouldn't want to pay the freight for an NFL franchise. I would venture to say that there's a huge percentage of people that don't want to pay any taxes at all. Right?
Yeah. Some of them star in movies.
right.
Okay. Well, let's get another perspective on something we've touched on already, and that is the historic capital, if you will, that is at stake here.
This is the old St. Louis Stamping Company building, and you know, we're in the middle of an area that I think a lot of people have written off, but they don't know about projects like this one. This was vacant for almost 50 years until a developer named Craig Heller purchased it, tried to get it listed in the National Register of Historic Places, ultimately succeeded. That enabled tax credits to be available. Because of this project, we were able to save a very historic industrial building that was, you know, probably going to be a goner. I mean, the irony is the stadium comes and takes us down after $9.8 million has been put into this building, after Missouri taxpayers have paid for low-income and historic tax credits to be used in this building. Sort of strange. Not too long ago, this area was desolate. It's starting to come back. It's a very slow process. In St. Louis, you know, redevelopment on this level is very slow. Maybe that's why we love these big projects. They solve all of our problems at once. When you think about the 56 apartments here and the families that are in housing, getting job training, getting out into their own housing, turning around their lives, the multiplier impact of that is really, really hard to measure. And displacing this facility, you know, affects dozens of people's lives and a whole network of social support that's been built very carefully. The team wants to honor the tailgating tradition, which is open air. I think they think tailgating in a parking garage doesn't have the same luster. Do they need that much parking? Probably not. Can there be some surface parking? Some structured parking and buildings like this one all sharing the same space? Of course, there's an easy compromise here. The buildings that are protected and that are worth saving are few. Most of them already have designation. So the size of the stadium and the parking demands can coexist. The question is, will that happen? So we're in the North Riverfront Industrial Historic District, a National Register District that honors some pretty impressive purpose-built buildings. I mean, these are cold storage warehouses, two massive powerhouses, a historic bathhouse, and warehouses. These are artifacts of a time when St. Louis was one of the nation's most wealthy and prosperous industrial powerhouses. These come from a time when we were still competing with Chicago to be the inland empire, the seat of commerce in the middle of America. The stadium would disrupt this area, though. They would take down the Laclede powerhouse, which TrailNet at one point thought could be a trailhead, a facility at the start of this 18-mile trail that goes up to the chain of Rocks Bridge. It's shown obliterated on the plans, as are these giant castle-like warehouses. These cold storage warehouses were built by Thomas McFeeters. In the background is the Cotton Belt Freight Depot. The Cotton Belt is probably best known as a really rundown, very skinny, 30 feet wide, very long, 750 feet long freight depot marked by graffiti. But just this last year, at the end of 2014, a group of volunteers raised enough money to paint this beautiful, colorful mural on the side of the building. The football stadium would spare one building, which is the Ashley Street Powerhouse, the largest powerhouse here, which is still in operation, serving the downtown steam loop. It's owned by Trigen, which maybe goes to show that every building needs a function to survive. That building is too expensive to tear down because you'd have to build a new steam plant somewhere. I see a future market for these buildings, but the proponents of the stadium probably look at what happens right now. They see there's no market currently.
There's nothing going on. These buildings are empty. And I see the projects like the stadium and the City Arch River project increasing the interest and increasing the likelihood. So maybe the competition is two competing worldviews that are based on two different timelines, now and later. It's all about, do you want to build neighborhoods or do you want to build islands of capital? I think the city deserves neighborhoods. But again, we have a slow demand in St. Louis, and so things don't happen overnight. I think that we'll regret taking a lot of these buildings down when we have an aging stadium that looked new once upon a time. And we're in that same boat right now. Nobody loves the current stadium. Once upon a time, though, it was shiny and new on a piece of paper, and the mayor held a press conference, and the world went crazy. We've already forgotten that 20 years later, and that fate will probably befall this building we're going to build here.
Our thanks to Michael Allen and his perspective. We really appreciate it. Next time, we won't interview him in the middle of the street as to get him run over by a car. But let's combine a little of what he was talking about there, a little of what Steve mentioned previously, and kind of be optimistic and say the Rams are going to stay or some team may be here. Is this the best plan? Welcome to the table, Todd Antoine from Great Rivers Greenway and Tyler Meyer from Forum Studio. You know, Michael talked about that when the dome was unveiled, the world went crazy. The world went crazy to some degree when this was unveiled. It's in a supposedly, or not supposedly, but an officially, I guess, blighted area. Kind of changes the skyline to some degree. But are there other thoughts about this part of town that were already happening?
Yeah, actually there have been efforts underway for the last couple years based off of everything that's been going on with City Arch River and the work that the Great Rivers Greenway is doing on Lenore K. Sullivan Boulevard right now to extend that further north to connect to the Riverfront Trail, which is pretty much right where Michael was when in the video and all that. So there have been efforts underway now to connect that. We actually have kicked off a study for an open space and redevelopment plan that covers the general area from Laclede's Landing, 70, the Mississippi River, all the way north to the Stan Musial Veterans Memorial Bridge.
Right where this plan is.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Who are the stakeholders involved in this? Who would want to see this? Is it strictly a GRG project?
No, this is a project that is a partnership between the St. Louis Development Corporation and Great Rivers Greenway. But there's also been a lot of partners that have been involved in the City Arch River project and in Laclede's Landing, other city agencies, a lot of different entities up in that whole area that have been involved to some degree. And so this is what this plan is to kind of look at the open space and park amenities that could be along the river, continuing what we did at the Arch Grounds, continuing up to connect to the existing Riverfront Trail, but then use that as a leverage for how you could get other redevelopment to occur from an economic standpoint, no matter what that use could be.
And Tyler, your Forum Studio is working with GRG on this,
right?
Correct? So some of the buildings Michael was just talking about there, so could some of those in this vision be saved, redeveloped, reused, or are we too early in the process to know that?
I think they definitely could be. I mean, we're looking at all the assets of the site. So as Todd mentioned, there's going to be a great new landscape. This is the only place in St. Louis where you get a view of the river without the flood wall. We have Laclede's Landing, we have Lumiere Casino, the hotel, we have the Metrolink station. We have all the ingredients you need for a great mixed-use community. And in fact, that kind of community could evolve to include a stadium. So this process kicked off just as the stadium announcement happened, and what it's done, there's a lot more interest in the project, and we'll really evaluate what would happen if there's not a stadium and what would happen if there is. Either way, there's a lot of potential for development of this site and interest in that.
So it could look a lot different in the next, I don't know, what, 10 years, 5 years? Have you figured out a time frame on that yet?
It's probably a longer time frame than that, to be honest. Things, development doesn't always happen really fast. I mean, we can look at something like the Cortex development in Midtown in St. Louis, where it really took some investment at the beginning, but also getting the right team together and a lot of hard work over, say, 10 years to really see something booming now.
So the stadium, they're not mutually exclusive. The stadium could happen. You know, Steve suggests maybe the stadium could be somewhere else, but it could still happen on the North Riverfront, and there could be a way to preserve some of the stuff Michael just talked about as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think, as Michael said, I think that there can always be compromises. And I think all the images that we've seen so far just are what we've all seen. So I think that there's areas that they can go back and refine, particularly with Tyler and his group working on things and the folks in the stadium working together to kind of come up with some things that are win-wins for everyone.
I said I was surprised to hear you say you thought maybe the county might be the better spot. You want to elaborate on that a little bit?
Well, the county I think would be better would be St. Clair County in Illinois.
Across the river.
But just across the river, you'd be able to see it right from the new bridge. You'd be able to see it from the hotels on the Missouri side. You'd cross and see it over there. It would help build a balance across the river. So when the cameras look around, they see something across the river as well on both sides. It'd be a huge asset for the region, I think, to have it in Illinois.
Still a downtown, if you will, as far as the geography is concerned.
Yeah, it's very close. And in terms of highway access, off of the new 70 Bridge would be great access for the highway.
Tyler, you're an urban designer by trade, I know as well. Your thoughts on what Steve's saying, and then also just kind of when your first kind of reaction to the plan when you saw it.
Well, it's definitely interesting. I know there's been a lot of evaluation of sites that have gone into this, and I think what I would say, they've determined this is the best place for the stadium because of accessibility, because of the metro, because of the riverfront. It's a new gateway to the city with the bridge and the view, and that makes it a great place for development in any case. So you could say that means the stadium should be there. You could say the stadium could be somewhere else, so this opportunity could be capitalized for something else. I think that's part of the study, just to find out the best way to create a sustainable mixed-use development, either with or without the stadium.
I know, talking to Dave Peacock, he's very high on St. Louis. He's very excited about this project. Is he open to some of the things you guys are doing, or has there even been that dialogue at this point?
Yeah, no, I think he is. I mean, if you've seen some of the renderings even, it shows a trail connection that kind of comes along the river, actually, around the stadium. So I think that the designers, to their credit, have gone out there and looked at the site and realized that there's this sort of missing gap in the trail network right there, and to really look at how to connect that. So I think from that standpoint, they do see that there's the connectivity for the trail system that will just benefit the whole entire region to really make that a better connection on Mississippi.
This is kind of a topic that everyone can have an opinion on. Do you want to see the Rams stay in St. Louis? Do you think St. Louis should be an NFL city?
Oh, I'm a big sports fan. I mean, I'll say this. I'm a lifelong St. Louis. I'm a Cardinals fan through and through. But, you know, I do think that there's something to be said to having an NFL team here. I do think, though, that given what's been going on in St. Louis, there's a lot of priorities here that this region and our community needs to look at and address. And this is just one of them. But yeah, you know, I am a Rams fan. I've gone to games, and you know, I think it'd be a shame if they're gone.
Same question.
I think that was pretty well stated. I think it's of course great to have them here. We just need to do it in the most thoughtful way. And you know, how could this be an inclusive benefit to the entire region? And you know, right now it's a little early in the process to know how that's going to work out. But there are a lot of people who are going to work to make that happen.
Let's get everyone back at the table, but in order to do that in a production seamless kind of way and to get more of what you're saying on the air, let's go back to social media for 1 second. We'll be right back. As we went to the break there, Steve mentioned we're only talking about 8 games a year. How many games are we talking about a year?
10, including the preseason. We're only talking if they would ever make the playoffs.
So
12 and 99 in 2001.
So if we keep the current team 10 games a year, the new team will do better.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be allowed to go back to when the Rams are good, they won't let me in. Is that something we should be considering? This is only 10 games a year plus playoffs?
Yeah, but like I say, St. Louis especially, 10 dates, 11 dates, whatever, it makes a lot of difference in the city of St. Louis. It's a city that I think is on the uprise, but we don't want to plateau, we don't want to go backward. And to lose something that you already have, you made an excellent point. You never want to go backwards. You don't want to be last, and you don't want to lose what you have. Those two things are very important to progress, and we don't want to go backwards.
And I go back to the ancillary things that I talked about. It's, to me, and I think for a lot of people, this is more than just an economic issue. I go out and about during the course of the season, and everywhere I go, even when the Rams are bad, people say, what do you think about this with the Rams? What do you think about that with the Rams? This is something that is part of the fabric of a community when you have an NFL team. And I think that's something that we have to keep in mind, too. It's not just dollars and cents. It's not just numbers and decimal points. There's more to it. It's really part of the fabric of who we are.
So you're a sports guy, but you're also the guy who rode Metro to work, you told us. Yeah. Is there a responsibility, if not maybe on the shoulders of the average fan, but of our leaders, to take into consideration some of these other things we're talking about in terms of our built environment and our history and access and all these other things?
Without question. And if I'm of the belief, Alvin and I were just talking about this, if there are people out there to redevelop these buildings that have been sitting vacant for years and years, that's great. I hope we can find them. I think that'd be wonderful. But, and yes, there is a responsibility on the part of our leadership to make sure that they're doing things right. But at the same time, if we extend the bonds, then nobody is going to feel the tax pinch any more than they were feeling it yesterday. It's going to be identical to what it was. And that's the way I'm looking at it. I'm looking at it like refinancing a house. And ultimately, if you can do better, if you can make your community better, and I think an NFL team makes us better, I think you should do what you can to make it better.
I do. I think that for sure having an NFL team in St. Louis does make the city better, but I do think that there's also an economic component there as well. You look at, there's a wide spectrum of dollars in terms of not having the Rams in St. Louis and what that would mean. The regional chamber, when they lured or when they got the Rams to St. Louis in 1995, put a number on it of between $100 and $150 million. Now that's higher than what it actually is. The regional chamber doesn't have an estimate for the economic impact right now. The closest thing we can gauge with is the Baltimore Ravens. Maryland did a study in 2011 when the NFL was going through the lockout. And they said, had the season gone to waste and the NFL wouldn't have played, the local economies would have lost out on about $2 to $3 million. Now we're talking gas, hotels, stuff like that. The state would have lost out on more in terms of tax dollars and things of that nature. But it remains to be seen. The economic impact is not that big.
Should we vote on it? Are we going to vote on it? Randy mentioned extending the bonds, talking about the payments that would normally have been done, I believe, 2021 on the dome. The state's paying $12 million, the city and the county $6 million each, I believe, is what it is. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot going on in Jeff City. There's a quote every day in the paper. You're writing about it.
And there's a lot going on there in terms of people saying that we can get by without having a vote. And then there's plenty of people saying we do need to have a vote. And that still needs to be played out right now. I do know that I've talked to some people that advised the county, and they said they could extend those bonds without getting to a vote. Now, whether or not they'll do that remains to be seen.
Well, that's what politicians come in. You extend those bonds without a vote of the people, whoever's in office right now will not be in office shortly thereafter. So that would be, they would have to make that, literally the sacrifice to do so. I think there should be a vote on it because the people voted in both the county and the city that if you were ever going to use tax dollars for a new stadium, there should be a vote on it. You can get around that. But at the same time, it's another whole show, but this is where referendums come in to listen. Hey, we created this situation, so you got to let the people vote.
Well, we have a politician that won't be in office. He's the governor. He's done after 2016.
Right. Well, we have one in this office right now who I'm waiting to hear from, and that's the mayor of the city of St. Louis. I'm waiting for a comment from him because this is all supposed to happen in the city of St. Louis.
Well, and this is an opportunity for St. Louis to have a conversation about what we want the future of our city to be, whether, once again, it's an NFL team or it's a stadium or it's an investment in Metrolink. And I think those conversations need to be had. And putting it out to vote just allows, more involvement. And that's a really important part of this is no longer should things happen without everybody thinking about the consequences of 10 or 20 years in the future. We really need to be careful about where we're pushing our city forward and what we want other people to think of us.
I think one of the major pluses that hasn't been mentioned yet is the fact that whether or not the Rams stay in St. Louis, they're going to be out of the Dome. And that opens up the convention center to a lot more business. I think Dave Peacock said $20 million a year that could potentially add. Now, you talk to restaurant owners and hotel owners, and they'll say that a convention is just as good as a football game in terms of getting business.
And they can't, if I understand, the NFL scheduling is such that they can't book in advance the way conventions would like to.
No, that's correct.
Yeah, so it sits dormant for the entire football season, that part of the convention center. So it will open us up to a lot of other opportunities there. The other thing to keep in mind is it's not just 10 football games a year. 12 if they have a good year. But
listen, I can't get 12 dates a year.
But soccer is an opportunity too. And I don't think, yes. I mean, we should not overlook that. I mean, think about what St. Louis did and how we rallied around World Cup and how we rallied around the two games that we had last year. I mean, that was an amazing showing. And it's really like kind of a grassroots thing in St. Louis already. So I think there's that opportunity as well, that beautiful facility that's been proposed could be used for other things too.
One caveat, if the league were to say, to tell Stan Kroenke, you can't move, you have to stay in St. Louis, he will not build a new stadium. They will be playing in the Edward Jones Dome.
We're only going to do what we have to do, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, he would just say, like, I am not coughing up $250, $400 million and I don't want to be here.
2021. Right. We could be back here at this same date next year.
Exactly.
Discussing the same thing.
Exactly. They would just keep extending the lease. He would not build a new stadium.
Okay, I tell you what. You brought up soccer. Let's talk about soccer, but let's do it online because we're just about out of time on the air. Thanks to all of you for all your time. We appreciate it. We'll hang around for just 1 minute. Stay tuned at 9net.org, and you can find us online. We will talk soccer. We will also talk, big projects that solve all of our problems that Michael Allen mentioned. Downtown has developed over a long period of time. This wasn't a magic bullet that changed things there.
Right.
So we've got some things to discuss there. We'll find out what you're saying. We'll incorporate that, and we'll see you online in just a minute. Okay, so soccer, this beautiful stadium, to use your words, has a soccer configuration. We're also getting the U.S. Women's National Team in Busch Stadium here, I believe, before the season starts.
Correct.
We've done pretty well. Is there a realistic chance that we might see soccer? Is that something that is part of this?
The MLS commissioner is coming to St. Louis, if not in the next couple weeks, definitely in the next month or so. He's stated his intentions to have an expansion team in St. Louis. He said before that the MLS doesn't make sense as a larger league without a team in St. Louis.
And the idea when you were going to build it in Collinsville or a place like that, that didn't work out. I think they want it in the urban core, wherever that may be. Certainly, if you build the stadium, you're going to have the soccer team with it to fill some of those dates. And that's what it would be necessary, I think, for the plan to even go. If the MSL, you know, just said, like, we are not expanding anymore, there will not be a franchise in St. Louis, I think that would be a major blow to the entire stadium project.
Any soccer experts at the table, raise your hand, but do they want a stadium that large to put 30,000 people in, or do they want?
Yeah, the lower bowl. They don't want to fill up.
That's fine. They're okay with the top.
Yeah, the top.
That works for TV or whatever. Because I know Kansas City's is much smaller, and it's wildly successful.
If they had their choice, they would choose a smaller European-style stadium. There's no question about that.
Same thing in other markets.
But it's been successful in other places like Seattle.
And you could theoretically host, you know, World Cup preliminary games, things like that, where you could play in Busch Stadium. The field itself is jammed in there so much that, you know, when it literally is like the World Cup qualifying, things like that, then if it's a friendly, you can do it there. But for real, you know, FIFA game, they probably would not want to play in Busch Stadium. You would need a larger facility.
I thought it was FIFA. That's how much I know.
If it's a FIFA game, you've got a little controller.
Does our love for controller and youth soccer, we're crazy about youth soccer, no doubt. I have a cousin that every time I go to her house, she has the soccer on satellite. Do we use satellite still for that stuff? But you know what I mean, the international games are on. But does that love for youth soccer, would that really translate to a major league team, do you think?
For many years, St. Louis was considered the soccer capital of the United States. There was one year where SIU Edwardsville, UMSL, and SLU all won the national championships in their respective divisions. So St. Louis had the Division 1, 2, and 3 national champions in soccer. We still turn out tons of soccer players, and there is still a big and hardcore soccer fandom here. I hear about them because I'm not a big soccer fan, so I hear about them a lot. And I think that that group is, first of all, very active. If this ever did come to a vote and Don Garber would guarantee an MLS franchise for St. Louis, I think that's a group to mobilize, to get to vote. And I think that that's a group that is well-heeled enough that they could buy season tickets and make MLS work here in St. Louis.
Right. Well, and I wouldn't want to stereotype, but some of the younger talent related to tech that we're trying to attract to St. Louis might be more interested in a soccer team than a football team.
No question.
No question. No question. And I sat in Busch Stadium in a sleet storm and watched SLU lose to Howard 1-0, and the place was pretty much packed. Mm-hmm. And I was, just in the early teens at that time. But I still remember that. And you know, they're we're still out there.
We were trying to attract you then.
At that time, right.
Not anymore.
No, seriously, if it were there and there was a big-time soccer game there, a lot of people who don't normally go to soccer games, me included, we'd be there. Remember the Steamers? I used to go see some Steamers games. I was in college. We'd come back, go see them. Place be packed.
I have committed to buying season tickets for a soccer team if we get the stadium built. If the soccer fans help get this stadium built, I've committed to not only buying the season tickets, but wearing a scarf to the games.
Nice. What if we're not an NFL city? Can we do a smaller a soccer stadium without NFL?
That's conceivable. I don't know that Dave Peacock and Bob Blitz are working towards that, but certainly if you're not an NFL city, this could be an MLS city. I don't think there's any question about that.
Absolutely. Yeah, ask Tom Stillman, who owns the Blues. He said, like, hey, maybe seem like a pipe dream right now, but boy, he would sure love to have a basketball team in that facility to fill his dates and help him out and get the Blues stronger. So, I mean, it's not the end of the world if the Rams leave, but don't get me wrong, it would be a setback.
So become better at what you're already good at is kind of the theme of something that I think a couple of you guys were saying.
Absolutely, here. Absolutely.
And focus on your strengths.
And we can. I think that's the biggest issue is I think there's a lot of belief and our town has been beaten down, like Missy was talking about earlier. Over the course of the last 6, 8, 10 months, we've been beaten down, and certainly by the Rams, we've been beaten down. But I think the thing that we need to keep in mind as a community is for a long time, Jack Buck and Robert Hyland, who ran KMOX, we all remember Jack, they talked about how St. Louis was the best kept secret in America. And I think there's a lot of people that are happy with the secret part, but not the best part. We can be great. We can be as good as anybody. And I think that's the attitude that we need to take. We need to be really positive and feel good about ourselves in St. Louis because we can be.
Right. I lived on the East Coast when it happened. And I had people around where I worked at USA Today at the time. And when they were going to announce the second expansion franchise, it's like, guys, listen, because we're about to get a football team back. And when they said the Jacksonville Jaguars, I was crushed. And I didn't live here, and I'm a lifelong Dallas Cowboy fan, still am to this day. And I was crushed. I hurt.
Deflated.
Deflated, very good. And I felt bad for the region. I felt bad for the city. I felt bad for the region. There are people that don't live here anymore, live and die on every Cardinal baseball game. I was one of those, too. So it's not just here. It's all around the country that people are looking back and saying, like, we want the best for St. Louis, even though we don't live here anymore.
And on that day that happened, I got on an airplane with Jim Holder. We were covering that day for KMOX, and he was sitting in one seat. I sat in the other, and I said, our only chance is to get the Rams. And lo and behold, we wound up getting them. And I'd hate to be in that situation again where you lose out on an opportunity, and you're sitting saying, well, our only chance is the Raiders. We're better off, like I said earlier, keeping and doing everything we can to keep what we have rather than gamble that there might be somebody else coming.
Well, it's also a cautionary tale as well. You know, we lose out on the expansion teams. We made a somewhat unfortunate deal with the Rams, and now we're here talking about whether or not they're going to be going year to year or they're going to be leaving for L.A., particularly the top 25% clause.
Yeah, it all comes back to that lease. If it wasn't for that lease, we would not be having this discussion right now.
Which, and we'll wrap on this, but just kind of goes back to what you're saying. There is a limit to what we should do, and that we may have crossed that line.
Well, you can't do what we did before. You can't spend you can't even do right now what Indianapolis did. They have a $720 million stadium, and the public funding is about $650 million. You can't go that far. In Atlanta, public funding is about 20%. In Minneapolis, it's about 50%. that's what you're dealing with now. The typical NFL stadium, if it's not completely funded by the owner, has 20 to 30% public funding, and that's obviously what we're looking at here.
I think we're going for the safe play. We're trying to get the NFL to put some money in, whether it's $100, $200 million. They have skin in the game, so we're not, you know, banking on the Rams staying here. We're banking on the NFL putting money in and making sure that they feel committed to St. Louis. Right,
and so they are committed with that G4 fund.
But that's also a loan that somebody's got to pay back. Sure. And that's the owner, and right now I don't see him
paying
back.
And I think the proposal that's been presented so far is strictly to get the NFL's interest. And that's where, you know, the discussion earlier about how it could fit into this area in a better way or perhaps another spot in the region. I mean, they really think that this is the best way to get the NFL to invest here. That doesn't mean that it couldn't be done in a way that helps St. Louis more, or helps downtown more, or makes our riverfront even better. And I think that's what we've got to do to, you know, we can't just do exactly what the NFL wants. We do what we get close, but we also want to create some other great amenities for other people in the region who may not go to a football game. And the stadium should be programmed so it can hold soccer, but also a lot of other events.
Oh, yeah. You're right. The footprint that is there now is a football stadium with parking lot around it. That's got to change. I mean, because that won't stand up to what, you know, Kroenke wants to do in Inglewood, where it's an entertainment venue and mixed use and all that. The plan has got to develop to include more than just that football stadium. This is just, I think, the first rendition. And you're right. It was done to try to get the attention of the National Football League, and I think they did a great job, but it's got to be more than that.
And I think at the end of the day, the Peacock Blitz team, because Stan wasn't responding to phone calls, they said they have to get something for him to respond to, and this is the first salvo to try to get him to respond.
Thank you all very much. Appreciate your time. We'll leave it there.
Thank you.
Thanks, Katie.